words of wisdom, and now we'll move on to the panel discussion. I welcome the panel of experts, Dr. Sabni Ghosh Laskar from Mumbai, Dr. Nidhi Patni from Jaipur, Dr. Ashutosh Mukherjee from Varanasi, Dr. Avdesh Kumar Pandey from Chandigarh, Dr. Rahul Sharma from Jammu, and Dr. Pankaj Kumar from Chandigarh. So what we had seen in these abstracts presented is that there is an increased number of HPV positive cases there in countries outside India, and there are advances in molecular targeting, plus improvement in improvement and advancement in diagnostic imaging. That's why we want to reduce the target volumes to prevent organs at risk. And this will be the focus of our panel discussion. And I'll proceed with the first study which was presented, the NRG-HN002 trial, a randomized phase 2 trial for patients with P16 positive non-smoking associated locoregionally advanced oropharyngeal cancer. And I request Dr. Nidhi Patni to give her expert comments over this. Dr. Nidhi?
HPV in the places outside India, the incidence is definitely more. In India, we see lesser of these. And as sir has also mentioned, there are more of tobacco-related malignancies. And in this particular study, when I was going through it, I see that the smoking population, even in this HPV positive study, was almost to the tune of 30%. And the standard arm was not included in this particular study, because so far we do not have data to show that de-intensification is not still not the standard of care for HPV positive malignancy. So the two arms did not have the standard of care arm in this study. And another thing that I noticed was that almost 20% of the patients could not complete the 20 milligram per meter square dose of cisplatin in this study. And as far as the protocol that we are following is still what is mentioned in the evidence, and we are not going by the de-intensification as of now, but definitely it will be coming in the future, as AJCC8 has now included HPV as a separate staging entity. It is definitely around the corner.
Any other expert panelists who want to comment over this study? I will move to next study. So the next study was randomized clinical trial on 7 days a week post-operative radiotherapy versus concurrent post-operative radio chemotherapy in locally advanced cancer of oral cavity and oropharynx. I want Dr. Rahul Sharma to please give his expert comment and also the his own experience, personal experience. Dr. Rahul Sharma?
Actually, I was discussing the same thing with Dr. Sarbani Ghosh last year. The post-operative had high-risk cases. We know that after 2004, the high-risk head and neck cancer, they have been treated with post-operative chemoradiation. But the cost is very high. The toxicity is very high with this approach. All the efforts which we are making now is that, is there a subgroup of patients where we can spare them the toxicity of concurrent chemotherapy and replace or we can substitute this treatment option with altered fractionation radiation. I have searched some articles on this continuous accelerated irradiation in head and neck cancers in high-risk cases. These are all studies from the Poland. The first article which was published.
Yes.
The first article which was published in the radiotherapy oncology in 2000 by the same group, the Suvinsky, Rafael et al., it showed that there is significant improvement in loco-regional control in carcinoma oral cavity and oropharynx with the use of accelerated, continuous accelerated irradiation, but not in the case of CA larynx. So as a sequel to that study, they have done this study where they included only oral cavity and oropharyngeal high-risk cases for continuous accelerated irradiation. And they have shown that there is a trend in favor of the loco-regional control in favor of this concurrent chemo radiation. So CEIR is as yet not a substitute for CTRT in the adjuvant setting. However, there is another article from the same group where they have done a molecular profiling, and it was published in Radiotherapy Oncology in Red Journal in 2010, where they showed that the molecular profile of having low Ki-67, low 53, and high EGFR expression in oral cavity cancers, the accelerated form of radiation may be full. This is what I have found from the literature, and I would like to have comments from other fellow panelists.
Dr. Pandey, can you comment over this?
I cannot go beyond this because this is the still not established that we have to give 7 days a week or 5 days a week, and which is better.
Any other panelists who want to comment, or we'll move to the next study.
I just want to make a comment. You know, this group has done something very, actually it's a little disheartening to see this results, because you know, if you see, they have kind of adopted the risk stratification system proposed by Qianang in his old paper of 2001. But the other thing that is most importantly missing is they have no data, at least reporting on the extranodal extension, especially when they've categorized patients into high risk and low risk and intermediate risk. So this is something that is unusual for a paper that is reporting intensification of treatment in the adjuvant setting. So I think we should really look at this paper with a little bit of caution.
Exactly.
One more comment. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, one more comment. Actually, they have used 1.8 grape of fraction in both the arms. So it is increasing the OTT in the basically the CTRT arm. That is still not standard. We are giving 2 grape of fraction, and we know that the OTT has an impact on the overall survival as well as the control rates.
So in view of paucity of time, we'll move to the next study. Next study is a phase 2 trial of alternative volumes of oropharyngeal irradiation for de-intensification, AVOID trial, omission of resected primary tumor bed for squamous cell carcinoma of oropharynx. And I'll request Dr. Nidhi to please comment on this study to give what are the strengths and weaknesses of this study and other things.
So far, even TORS is not an 100% accepted treatment for this particular subset. And to move ahead on this, when you do TORS and do not radiate that particular region, the tumor bed, what we call, it appears quite fascinating, because definitely the side effects are likely to be reduced. But then again, we have to work with great caution on these, because it is a very small sample that was evaluated and follow-up was very small, barely 2.4 years for early cases. So this cannot be taken at its face value. And moreover, it was a non-randomized trials. And one more thing that I noticed was that there were photon and proton, both the modalities used in this particular treatment. So though the biological equivalent doses may have been matched with, but the toxicity profile would be definitely different, especially in the late toxicity when we consider. So this has to be further evaluated at a larger level to bring it to the board.
Any other comment from any other expert panelist? So we will move to our next study, which was now this is an interesting study, radiotherapy versus transoral robotic surgery for oropharyngeal squamous cell carcinoma. Who will give the final punch? And I'll request Dr. Laskar to please come in and give her expert comments about this study and what does she thinks will be better.
So see, this study just tells us one thing, that if you talk about oropharyngeal, see, this is a study that is not planned for HPV positive alone. It took all comers with oropharyngeal cancer. The orator 2 is specifically for HPV positive cancer. So what we need to remember from this study, the essential take home is that when you evaluate a patient with early stage oropharyngeal cancer, you have to give both options, that is surgery as well as radiation therapy. The thing that was being purported, that TORS would be better if you didn't, you know, because radiotherapy is associated with so much toxicity, is not correct. Of course, you cannot take any concrete messages from this trial simply because the trial numbers, the patients were only 68, 34 in each arm. There were certain things that are not routinely done. Just because they had one bleeding, they strongly recommended that all patients in the surgery arm should have undergo a tracheotomy. Now, that's not done for all patients. So that could be one of the possible reasons why the really unsafe. We can only say so much from this trial that if a patient comes to you tomorrow, please offer both possibilities and not only TORS or radiotherapy. You give patient both and explain to them both with the side effects. That's what I think should be the take home from this particular trial.
Can we say that we are at verge of giving a final push to TORS going by this study or continuing with studies?
I don't think so. I don't think we are yet poised there. This study does not tell us that at all. It just simply tells us that you should say, and then actually this trial has also said something that maybe for a certain group of patients where you don't need to do anything else, TORS maybe. See, TORS is good in only for 10% of oropharyngeal cancer patients, and that is something, whether they're HPV positive or HPV negative, we need to remember this, not for anything. And especially in our country, it may find no application because our oropharyngeal cancers are essentially based on cancers and not tonsillar tumors. So that is something that we need to keep in mind.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So we will move to the next study, and that is recurrence and quality of life following elective nodal volume and dose de-escalation for oropharyngeal and laryngeal cancer. Initial results from the INFIL trial. And I'll request Dr. Pandey sir to please come in and give his expert comments for about this study.
Look, there are a few drawbacks in this study. One, in one group, they are having 41 number of patients which are P16 positive. And in 7 patients, they have used accelerated radiotherapy also. So, and there is limited follow-up. Mm-hmm. So, history may be, or beside this, they have included all the stages. If they would have used stage 1 and 2, then I think this should have been a good history. Okay. And randomization is not better. So these are my few comments on this particular study.
Any other expert comments?
Also, if you see the concurrent chemotherapy that has been done, it's all over the place. There are several regimes that have been used. And surprisingly, with such a small number of patients, it's very difficult to actually form conclusions, except to say that maybe it can be taken up.
So, thank you, ma'am. We'll move to the next study, which is reduction of radiotherapy dose to the elective neck in head and neck squamous cell carcinoma, and its update of long-term tumor control of a randomized control trial. And I request Dr. Ashutosh Mukherjee to please comment over this study. Dr. Ashutosh?
Am I audible, firstly?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir. Please go ahead.
Hello.
We are not audible.
Ashutosh, you are loud and clear.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think the whole group will have to...
Sorry. Actually, the voice is cracking at this end.
Okay, I'll request Dr. Pankaj to...
What I wanted to say...
Yes, Dr. Ashutosh, go ahead. Can Dr. Pankaj come in? I think we have a bad connection with Dr. Ashutosh.
Yeah, hi. So this is a dosing de-intensification trial. So they have used 40 gray versus 50 gray to elective volumes. So all the trials that have been done in denasification are mainly in the HPV positive setting. So in this paper, around 20% patients are having HPV positivity, others are having HPV negativity in the oropharyngeal region. So in this trial, the first thing is they have used the primary endpoint as the dysphagia. So still now we don't have a standard of care of lower dose elective regions in any of the sites of head and neck cancer. So we should first have a trial. We should address the answer to the question that dose intensification does lead to similar tumor control as compared to the normal standard deviation that we are using these days. Yeah. So in this trial, they have used 40 gray versus 50 gray, and the failures were more in the 40 gray arm in the regional lymph nodes. But they have shown that the regional lymph nodes are mainly in the high-risk PTV and not in the outside the PTV or in the low-risk PTV. So the main thing that I want to convey is that we should first conduct a proper trial to first know the proper de-intensified dose in patients of head and neck cancers. Then we should go ahead with their toxicity and the other aspects of the treatment.
Any other expert comment?
If all the patients are usually in stage 4, then I think this dose de-escalation is not a good hypothesis, because chances of involvement of multiple lymph nodes with disease is quite high. So I think this is better if we take stage 1 or 2 cancer only.
Nirav, is our connection with Dr. Ashutosh okay now? So we'll move to the. I think he is. Is the connection with Dr. Ashutosh okay now?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Ashutosh, can you hear us?
I can hear you, but can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear. Please, want to comment on this study?
So regarding that trial by Sarah Deschmeer from the Dutch group, what I wanted to say is in 2018, we already had a study from PMH where they studied the isolated local recurrences as well as the loco-regional recurrences versus the toxicity to the thyroid and the salivary glands, the parotid. For elective nodal radiation at doses of 50 gray, and they found that the elective area, the doses could be brought down to 50 gray.
Yes.
We also have dosimetric data that for hypo as well as for the salivary gland, irreversible damage occurs beyond 40 to 40. Having said this, the paper by Newens, the previous paper to this by Newens and Sandra Nuet were the initial papers on elective nodal doses for 40 gray, and they have tested non-inferior to 50 gray. There was also another paper by Salama et al. In 2013, which studied for 36 gray, and there the results were poor. So taking all this into account, I would say the 45 to 50 gray is till now should be the standard unless we have more data. And 40 gray would probably be the lower edge of the cliff, after which there is the abyss of loss of control. So I think 40 gray is perhaps the end of the line, and we should think more towards 45 to 50 gray as an elective nodal dose.
So let us move to the next study now. So this is a pick of the study for me because it is taking radiation to the next level by using stem cell sparing IMRT for head and neck cancer patients. It was a double blind randomized controlled trial, and I want Dr. Lasker to please comment on this study and give her expert comments. And can we go about it, or what is the option of this type of studies in India, where far we are?
Actually, the concept is very interesting, and it has been proven in animal models, because the initial experiments done by Sarah Pringle and Peter Van Leeuwenhoek actually showed that you could grow these cells that had been spared, and these were the only cells that could grow in the medium. So there is evidence to say it can be done. What is more challenging is the concept of having to actually outline this area, which is supposedly at least supposed to be on the dorsum of the mandible at the first branching of the Stenson's duct. So now that is what is a challenge, because the point is that in your day-to-day practice, in which cases are you going to be able to do it? Because if you see the study, what they've done is they've tried to give the entire thing a standard IMRT plan, and then for the optimized plan, they've tried to spare this area particularly. So main thing is going to be a dosimetric challenge. I think it brings into practice the thing of, you know, highlights the importance of image guidance and also of adaptive radiotherapy being done in the right sense, you know. So I think it is something that is worth pursuing, but it has to be done very carefully and only if you're very certain and sure of your contouring.
And ma'am, wherefore we are at India from these kind of treatments?
You know, it's an individual thing. Now, supposing I had the time, the luxury of time, I would like to do it in my patients. And also for the kind of disease that I see, I may not do it in my nasopharynx because I would have a high incidence of, say, parotid nodes or something, or say in an unknown primary where I really don't know. But in somebody who doesn't need treatment for the parotid region and I can, and my nodes are well away, I think I may still want to do it with good image guidance and following a daily image guidance protocol. I think the daily image guidance or the image guidance protocol will make a difference here, and the certainty of contouring the region.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for those comments. The next study, please. Next slide. So this is also an important study, but though nasopharyngeal carcinoma is not so much of a problem as told by sir in our region, our country, but definitely for Northeast region and upper belt, this cost effectiveness of screening for nasopharyngeal carcinoma with serology or plasma Epstein-Barr virus DNA in high incidence population globally. And I'll request Dr. Pandey, because he has so much interest in prevention. Dr. Pandey, sir, please give your expert comments over this study.
This study actually not fit for India, because this is quite costly study. And we are having only nasopharyngeal carcinoma to a limited group of, limited part of India. So this study is very costly and not cost effective, because even in their study, they have shown that nasopharyngeal carcinoma is more than or equivalent to 0.25% of all the cancers. So this is quite limited number of cancer, not a fit study for India. And this screening is not cost effective. It is very significant reduction in death, and there is no significant reduction in death and survival. If you see the last part of this study, they have shown that there is reduction in stage 3-4 death and survival, but it is not so significant that we should invest so much money on this study, and that's why this is not so good study for me.
So in view of shortage of time, we'll move to the next study. Next slide, please. This is a pilot study of durvalumab with tremelimumab in combination with image-guided stereotactic body radiotherapy in treatment of metastatic anaplastic thyroid cancer. And I request Dr. Rahul Sharma and Dr. Pankaj to give their expert comment. Then we'll wind up. Dr. Rahul?
Yeah, actually, durvalumab is a PD-L1 inhibitor, and tremelimumab, this is a CTLA-4 inhibitor. This is the dual immune checkpoint inhibitors, and they have been found active in case of malignant melanoma and lung cancer. But unfortunately, this study has not shown any response in anaplastic thyroid cancer. The only targeted therapy which has shown promise in anaplastic thyroid cancer is the BRAF inhibitors, only in BRAF V600 mutant cases. And there also they have used dual inhibition with dabrafenib and along with the trametinib, which is a MAP kinase inhibitor. So it is the MAP kinase, mitogen activated protein kinase inhibition pathway, that has been the target. This is a negative study, and the response is 0%. They have reported a 0% response with this dual immune checkpoint inhibition.
So with that, I thank my Dr. Pankaj, you want to comment?
And nothing, actually, we don't see much anaplastic thyroid cases Okay. So, your experience is very limited with these cases.
So I'll wind up. I'll thank my panelists for such enlightening panel discussion. To sum up, RT and surgery are with emphasis on quality of life or the backbone of head and neck cancer treatment, we all know, and present and evolving systemic agents are there, but they have a rider of cost. Toxicity is a greatest barrier, and clinical trials and evidence will continue to provide the, you know, core underpinning. So multidisciplinary approach will definitely help us to fight this cancer. And I'll request our worthy chairperson, Dr. G.K. Rath sir, to give his expert comments before we wind up.
Thank you very much. The only 2-3 points I want to make at the end is that some things which we should not attempt in this country. Number one is this 7-day radiotherapy. See, I have seen two disasters happening, in one in UK, the other in US, where initially when the cervical cancer, remote afterloading started, so one in Western General Hospital, another in US, in Texas. So they, see, as you know, the US and UK, they crave for the weekends. Weekend means nothing is done. So in India, it could be probably done, but they have also landed very, fared very badly, and the sources have been stuck, because radiotherapy is a process, it's a system, it's not a tablet to take. So this probably, if somebody has to do it, it has to be done as a trial setting. The second thing is the TARS, as Sarvani told very nicely, that in our country, probably 5-10% people in majority of centers, unless it's a huge head and neck cancer center, only 5-10% people are suitable for TARS. So to attempt that and make it as a routine probably is not the right thing. And in nasopharyngeal cancer is not our priority actually. If you think what's our priority, it is still, lung cancer in breast and lung in men and breast in female. If you think nasopharyngeal cancer is common in northeast, if you see what is commonest is cervical cancer in Pepunpure. In Arunachal, Nagaland is the only place, very little of Mizoram, where nasopharyngeal cancer is common. But studies can be done. So one has to be careful in, investing your money in these studies. So I'll still come back that prevention is better. 60% of head and neck cancers are preventable. 60%.